Once upon a time, I really thought I could change the world. Make a difference in the midst of all that chaos. But that was way back when. When I was someone. Someone who was at the forefront of the revolutionary vanguard. Yeah, I was the voice of the people. But now? Now I'm nothing but a washed up, rinsed out, retired radical.
Welcome to Polishing Turds with Nick and Cal. My name is Nick.
I'm Cal.
And this is the show where we take a deep dive into the wonderful...
That was pretty good. That was rhythmic.
I'm just like, I'm really testing the limits of my improv skills at this point. I want to come up with something that's so random and annoying that you actually get up and walk out of the room.
I've thought that, actually. People are fickle, and they might hear the podcast intro and she's like, yeah, no.
even men as strong as Cal have a breaking point. All right, folks. Welcome to the final installment of our series on the obstreperous, opportunistic octet known as Chumbawamba. All right. You excited, Cal?
Oh, a little.
Yeah, a little.
Sorry.
No.
I know. I'm supposed to like charge in.
Come on. We gotta get the audience excited.
I'll tell you what I'm excited about, Nick, is there's always fascinating parts of these stories that I'm not expecting. Mm-hmm. And I know we'll get to one. The reason for my gut reaction is when we got to the end of Chumbawamba, it's like watching your friend who used to be cool and now you're watching him try the same shtick at the bar and you're kind of like, let's do something else. You know what I mean?
Maybe you've had one too many whiskey drinks.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I know that actually in itself there is a fun way to present and talk about that story, but that is where we're at with these guys. They're in the twilight of their career.
It kind of is. We're definitely going to see some things from them that are still very, very Chumbawamba-y in a good way. Like with Chumbawamba, it's all about the context, right? It's about how are they reacting to the world around them. And the world around them is in this particular time period. And here we're talking about like basically the whole 21st century thus far,
yep,
which is a pretty fucked period. I think we can all agree. So how does the band that earnestly wants to save the world deal with a crumbling husk of late capitalism that we're all living with? That is going to be the theme of this episode.
Because of all the Chumbawamba research, I got the algorithm starts giving me articles on my phone and stuff like that.
Sure.
And there was some website that I'm sure it was written by an AI, but trying to say that it was good albums by bad bands.
Okay.
And they listed Tubthumping as the good Chumbawamba album. And after all we've been through, I kind of took personal offense to it.
No, they were wrong.
That's absolutely wrong. It's the opposite of what I think has happened.
And I, to be fair, some Chumbawamba fans earnestly think that Tubthumper is their best album. But no, I don't. I think we've already proven that that's not the case.
Yeah, the only way I could see thinking that is if you stripped back all the historical context or anything about this band as people,
you
could maybe say it's the best.
If you were like a right winger, like who just didn't like to listen to the lyrics, even then it'd be tough. But you could at least passively coast through this album. All right. But speaking of Tub Thumping, I wanted to share something with you, Cal, that honestly should have gone into the last episode because the whole point of that one was we really tried to like just talk about everything related to Tub Thumping the song, but I missed something. And something that I really shouldn't have missed. This is just a brilliant little musical artifact. And I'll tell you what, I wrote a whole preamble, but I just want to play this, and then we'll react to it later.
Dude, all right, missed opportunity. That's got to go in the wedding playlist.
Yeah, dude.
Just to watch people kind of perk up and go, wasn't this that other song?
Wait, what am I? Like, you see a guy start square dancing. He's like, hey, didn't I see this on VH1 20 years ago?
Yeah.
That's, dude, like, believe it or not, guys, that is not an AI creation. They actually recorded that back in 1997. It appeared on a Japan-only mini album.
That makes no sense. I'm trying to make sense of it, and I wanted to come in here with like a nice cogent analysis, but what? Of all the countries that might pick up on that, that's the last one on my list.
I'm sure that there is an actual, like, legit economic reason that I was just too lazy to look up before this moment. But if you happen to know what the real reason for that is, and I know we actually have some fans who live in Japan, so DM us and let us know what this shit is all about. But okay, let's get on to the real episode. Now, when we last left off, Chumbawamba's 15 minutes of fame had run its course. It had been an incredible journey, one that put their faces on TV and allowed them to travel all over the world while supporting social causes that the band held dear to their hearts. They avoided the trappings of behind-the-music rock and roll excess, so no smashing up hotel rooms or overdosing in public for these chumbas.
Darn.
I know, which, again, I will say, like, if that had been their career trajectory, I would respect these guys more if they went like full Oasis after 10 years of being like these super militant, disciplined anarchists.
I know, they kind of just like, they're just trailing off like normal people.
Yeah.
Which is tough. Like, we have to make this interesting.
But no, like, they, you know, yeah, like you said, they were just very mature by this point. Like, they had a whole system of conflict resolution based on meetings and meetings and meetings. And, like, I think they had learned to keep their egos in check just by virtue of, like, fucking living in the same house and dealing with each other for so goddamn long that, like, no amount of money could, like, split them apart.
It is an amazing thought experiment. You know, like, if you're a record company and you're trying to hire a band, you're kind of used to competing egos.
Yeah.
But with these guys, you're basically getting like one, it's almost like getting one person, like a solo yeah. artist.
Like one eighth of an artist in one hive
yeah,
mind.
Yeah, it's a hive mind. They are so used to these meetings at this point.
I wonder if there were any meetings where like someone in some agency tried to pull over Dunstan Bruce, be like, I listen to me. Listen to me, kid. You're the real star of this group. These other seven guys, they can go fuck themselves. You're the sexy
when
one.
When I heard the goods, kid. When I heard you say, drinks a whiskey drink, I knew you were the star.
But no, that isn't what happened. What did happen was that, people got tired of Tubthumping. Their follow-up, WYSIWYG, didn't do so well. Which, by the way, I learned something interesting about the term WYSIWYG. This is courtesy of one of our fans. Apparently, WYSIWYG was an acronym that was used in the world of graphical computing. You know, so like when Microsoft Word first came out, you could see what you were typing in real time. you know, for the first time. So like these programmers learned this acronym, what you see is what you get, WYSIWYG.
Okay.
I don't know if Chumbawamba were aware of that at all.
No, I bet there's no way that's coincidence. There's no way.
Yeah, but that's a really interesting little tidbit.
That is, thanks.
But okay, so WYSIWYG fails, and then 2002, they depart with EMI, and basically, they're kind of just content to return to the obscurity from which they had emerged. And here I think the band faced a dilemma that we've seen them face time and time again, which is the question, what next? Like, what do we do now? And for a band whose very identity lies in defying expectations, it is very much up in the air, what will the 21st century hold for Chumbawamba? You see, in many ways, I find the timing of this whole meta-narrative somewhat ironic. Chumbawamba, a highly conscious political band, came of age in the mid-90s, one of the most apathetic times in recent memory. When we think of the 90s today, most people regard it with relative fondness. The economy was pretty good, and America and Britain weren't embroiled in any major wars. The decades since have borne witness to a seemingly endless cycle of decay and ruin, with wealth inequality and political divisions tearing society apart, and the existential threat of climate change casting a cloud of doom on our collective unconscious. One could argue that on paper, the Chumbawamba of old, the scrappy punks agitating for revolution, might seem more at home in our current times than the ones they came up in. Yet, as the post-9/11 hellscape we live in grew ever more unseemly, Chumbawamba's music actually grew calmer, more mature, more reflective, still decidedly left-wing, but without the sneering hostility that defines much of anarcho-punk music. And again, Cal, like, I think a lot of this is just the fact that they're in their fucking 40s, you know?
Right. I get it.
Yeah. Oh, no, for sure. Like,
you cannot be a punk forever. You just can't. And you can still have radical thought or, like, ideas, but you're not going to be so gung-ho, cram it down other people's throat as you were before.
Yeah, like something about you just knows to just be at peace with things, kind of. Otherwise, like, you just end up becoming the worst asshole that anyone knows.
Well, you end up becoming the psycho conspiracy guy.
Yeah, exactly.
After a certain point, like, your chance to rock the boat kind of passes.
Yeah.
And your desire to.
Yeah, I'm very passionate about a lot of my political beliefs, and I really want the world to change, and I want people to suffer less than they currently are. But there's also part of me that just kind of shrugs his shoulders and be like, yeah, this fucking shit again.
Well, yeah, because you're one crewman on a massive ship.
Yeah.
And there's just no way around that. And that comes with age.
Yeah.
You get older and you just kind of realize I'm one puzzle piece.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's just, there's something about growing older where the feeling of emotional immediacy that you relate to every single thing with, like, just even when I was like 20, like, it wasn't just like politics, it was just like
I got offended
when, like, people had bad taste in music or movies, or, like, just, you know,
you drive Ford instead of Chevy.
Yeah,
what the fuck.
Yeah, I got pissed off when people, like, took too long to, like, put sugars in their coffee at the Quick Trip counter. Like, just stupid
My
shit,
favorite was when a kid was acting up on a plane. I would always catch myself thinking, "What? Why isn't that fucking parent controlling that kid?"
Yeah,
and now that I have him,
it's
going,
so easy, right?
Yeah, I look back, like, what did I want him to do? Start hitting him on the plane? Like, what did I think was the option?
Yeah. No, it's just like, life fucking happens to you, and that's a good thing. And I'm not even saying that young people shouldn't be passionate anymore. Like, you have to go through
all that.
I
wish they'd be more passionate. That's what's weird about when, like you said, when Chumbawamba hit their peak.
Yeah.
It's kind of an odd time.
No, the fucking slacker generation is fucking stupid.
I want to see more of the current generation doing Chumbawamba shit, getting mad about something.
Yeah, exactly. Well, maybe they kind of are. Like, there's, like, Greta Thunberg, you know, there's, like, the Z's are, I think, a little bit more with it than we were. Like, yeah. maybe they're wrong about other things, you know. But,
we had the luxury of being in the best time and place to ever be a human in recorded history.
Oh, for sure. Like, we've talked about this in private a lot. I think, like, 2006 was the best era of technology because you had the internet, you had access to information, but it wasn't, like, so immediate and so constant that it was, like, rewiring your brain.
Yeah, and corporations hadn't taken control of every website you visited yet.
Yeah, for sure. Like, no, it was, like, honestly, people don't talk about that enough, but, like early 2000s, like, musically fucking terrible. Musically, we lived in a nadir, but technologically, fucking based. All right, so in 2002, the dawn of this retroactive technological golden age we're talking about, a newly independent Chumbawamba started up their own record label, Mutt Recordings. Now, the first release on Mutt Recordings...
It's a fitting name, by the way.
They are kind of... They're a
musical mutt.
They're a musical mutt, you know? They should have called it Platypus. But I digress. The first release on this label was their 10th studio album, Ready Mades, an album which, once again, saw the band devise an entirely new approach to music making. This time, they drew inspiration from none other than late 90s VH1 icon and classic Eminem hater, Moby.
Ooh, lordy, trouble so hard. Ooh, lordy, trouble so hard. Don't nobody know my trouble but God. Don't nobody know my trouble but God.
Yeah, so Moby actually, like Chumbawamba, started out in the early 80s in the, like, hardcore punk scene.
There's a lot of that, man. Between him and Bjork and...
Yeah.
Like, I'm learning how many people came out of this group.
It's my favorite fact about hardcore music is how many artists started out playing that, like, very specific, very dialed in and simple... sounding music and went on to make some of the most creative stuff ever made. Like, it's really one of my favorite stories in, like, all of musical history. That song that we just heard incorporated a sample of like an old field recording blues song by an African-American singer from, like, the 30s, and he mixes it with, like, electronica music plus, like, some, like, piano and bass that he plays himself. And that was basically, like, the structure of that whole album, right? And it, like, sold amazingly well, and it was, like, one of the biggest albums of that year.
Modern day Elvis.
Like, kind of, like, except
almost not even, he's not even, like, re-performing it.
No, like, he's like, it's like the unsexy version of Elvis. Like, he's not even packaging it in a way that's gonna make, like, teen girls, you know, wet themselves. But honestly, like, Moby's, like, kind of a controversial figure. I really like that album, and I like a lot of the stuff that he's done, like, but a lot of people don't. And,
well, you can get stomped by Obi, Nick.
Yeah, if you hate him based purely on what Eminem brainwashed you to think back in the 90s, like I kind of was, I get that too. But Chumbawamba basically took that premise of, like, sampling old folk music and repurposing it, and they decided that they would do the same thing, but with English folk music.
Okay.
So if you're curious how that turned out, this is a sample that they took from a guy named Henry Cox. He had a song called The Pretty Plowboy. Let's hear a little bit of that.
So when the aged parents, they came for to know that his love was blowing on the plain, they sent for the press gang and pressed our love away, and they send him to the wars to be slain, And they sent him to the wars to be slain.
I love old English and Irish folk music. Is just like some drunk sailor guy caterwauling on the docks.
It really is.
It's the type of shit that if someone was doing it now at like Target, you'd call the fucking cops. But back then it was a folk song.
I know. It's just, no, it rings of authenticity through and through. Like, you close your eyes and, like, you are on the seashore. You can hear the waves and just...
Well, fucking... And you see old crazy Tom just... He does that every night. Fuck him.
I mean, but just imagine if you were, like, on a ship for, like, 2 years and that was the only type of music you... that was available to you, and it was like the same guy that you had to like sit down to dinner with that guy too. that'd be a trip, man.
No one tell Tom he sucks. He's all we got, honestly. He's the only one who wants to sing this stuff at night. So
he honestly isn't even a good sailor. He can't really like grip the rope super well, but you know, he likes to sing, and you know, it's just nice to have He's around
good vibes.
Okay, so they took that song, The Pretty Plowboy by Henry Cox. we told ourselves
we'll avoid it.
We told ourselves we were too good for that, Cal. We gotta stick with it. Okay, so they took that song by Harry Cox and they remixed it into this song, which is called Jacob's Ladder.
Like rusty old nails at the bottom of the sea, telling your tale. When you told to through the open door, and the king of Norway, he's the man you all died for. On this Jacob's ladder, the only way up is down. 3 days in the water, watching all the secrets drown. Jacob's ladder.
And I send him to the
then you really might know what it's like.
Yeah, kind of. Harry Cox knew what it was like to sing the blues.
Yes.
Oh, shit. It's Henry Cox. I fucked that up.
No, it's not just you. Like almost every YouTube comment I read.
No,
his
shit.
Name has kind of just retroactively become Harry Cox.
He should, you know what? I'm changing it. It is Harry Cox. That's
if
I'm
your
sorry.
Last name is Cox and you don't name your son Harry, you're missing an opportunity.
Yeah, for real. And plus, he probably died in like 1972, so I don't imagine his estate coming after us.
It was Henry.
I'm sorry. We love you, Henry. You're fucking based. Okay, so. Let's talk about what that song is actually about. Yeah, we've seen this time and again with Chumbawamba. You always
can't escape it, man.
You need footnotes.
Thing is, man, I will tell you, Nick, the feedback I have gotten on this series, people like the context.
Okay, they're
in it for this nerd shit, dude.
They better, because the nerd shit is my bread and butter. Like this is what I live for, people. And this one is really just like. Even relative to the other ones, this is a doozy, man, because we've talked a lot about some obscure history in the course of talking about Chumbawamba. We've talked about miners' strikes and, old agrarian, collectivist mm-hmm. movements. But we haven't talked anything about World War II naval history.
Honestly, how is that possible? Of all the things we talked about, I would have thought this would have been right up there.
I mean, to be fair, like if you talk to a British person for 10 minutes, like
you're getting
naval history will probably come up.
Yes.
So it was perhaps inevitable that at some point Chumbawamba would write a song about the sinking of the HMS Glorious in June of 1940.
Oh, yes. Near and dear to my heart.
So here's what happened, folks. In 1940, a British aircraft carrier named the HMS Glorious took part in an evacuation of British troops and aircraft from the Norwegian coast. So the ship was part of a big naval convoy, And at some point after the evacuation, for whatever reason, it split off from the main naval convoy and proceeded back toward Britain, accompanied only by two destroyers named the Acasta and the Ardente. Now, normally, when an aircraft carrier in a time of war is proceeding alone in the open sea, it would be accompanied by reconnaissance aircraft. It would also have aircraft ready on deck in case there were enemy ships nearby. It would also have a lookout for enemy ships nearby. And for whatever reason, none of this was the case on the HMS Glorious on the afternoon in question. So, on June 8th, the Glorious and her two destroyers were intercepted by two German battleships who proceeded to attack and sink all three ships, resulting in the deaths of over 1,500 sailors. It was the biggest British naval disaster of World War II. I'm sure they've made movies about this, but like none that were, you know, directed by Christopher Nolan or anything.
The Naughty Navy Hour was inspired by this.
No, this is the naughtiest Navy moment.
You can't leave him without aircraft carriers.
So this is like a really big deal at the time. And honestly, like over the ensuing decades, there was a lot of controversy as to how the HMS Glorious was left so exposed. And one of the kind of quasi-conspiracy theories points to the fact that there was a British cruiser nearby that could have come in and bailed out the Glorious, and the Glorious did send distress signals, and it was proven that this other cruiser did receive those signals, but that cruiser ignored him and kept proceeding back toward the British coast. And one reason, perhaps, was that the cruiser was secretly escorting the Norwegian royal family. You know, so the idea is basically that rather than help out their fellow, you know, ship, they had to protect these royals at all costs.
Well, yeah, you have to keep the... So you have to keep smoked trout coming into your nation. And you can't do that if Norway's mad at you. No, dude, I play a lot of Civilization. I play a lot of Crusader Kings video games.
Mm-hmm.
So this hits a little home for me. I get both sides.
Yeah.
It's giving up people's lives in exchange for a more important person's life.
Yeah.
It's a tough thing to wrap your head around.
Yeah, it's like 1,500 you know, men for essentially one guy.
One guy. And is he even good at his job? Maybe not. That's the thing that sucks with societal structures.
Most kings were never good at their jobs. You know, like, this is what pisses me off when, like, these, like, Andrew Tate, you know, motherfuckers talk about how, like, we have to have kings, you know, I want every man a king. They're thinking of like fucking Aragorn, you know.
Mm-hmm,
they're not
right.
Thinking of like most kings throughout history were just like random inbred
right,
douchebags.
Right. It's, oh, I guess I'm the king now. My uncle died. Like it's always some bullshit.
Yeah, and the fucking like court advisors actually run the country while they, you know, fuck the chambermaid.
That is exact. Quick plug for Crusader Kings 2, the video game.
Okay.
It taught me all this shit. You basically are tasked with running a lineage of your country, and just the most fucked up shit happens. I don't even, Game of Thrones simulator is how, like, the only way I can describe it.
Yeah, all right. Well,
and it happened. It's all like what you just said. You're some kid. You have a regent for most of your life who's actually running the country. You become of age. You're still just some moron who has the title somehow.
And
that's most kings.
I imagine you constantly have to worry about like assassination plots
and
shit like
constantly,
that
constantly, because of the way inheritance laws used to work.
You know what? Like
Scar from The Lion King was a life lesson.
Oh, for sure, man. Dude, it is not good to be the king. Like,
no,
I don't
horrible.
Think it'd be fun at all.
Even the level of boss I already am is uncomfortable sometimes.
Oh, 100%. No.
Being the boss sucks.
Yeah, it totally does. It's just constant fucking anxiety. And the people who like lust after power, you know they're fucking deranged.
Yes.
Yeah, so maybe the guy who set himself on fire was right. but anyway, like, so, and I think that this was like kind of the angle that Chumbawamba was taking with this story, is because there's a lyric in that song, and the king of Norway, he's the man you all died for. So I think that's like what they're kind of thinking.
Yeah, and they're right. That's the inherent flaw of hierarchy leadership that we all follow and we all innately understand.
Mm-hmm.
You're assigning this weight to somebody who is still just a guy.
Yeah. And it's like, and it's just, and in the context of war too, it's really tragic because, you know, like 95% of the people who sign up to fight in wars and to join the army are just truly noble, brave people who yep. believe in a true cause, and they can have their lives ended at the whim of some careerist douchebag who like would be better suited to be on the board of some fucking insurance company. It's really sad.
Yes.
So, you know, that's kind of how a song that's about a naval, you know, battle kind of fits into the Chumbawamba canon, you know, because we're still talking about authority. We're talking about the horror of war and just the folly of being made to do something dumb by someone else.
Oh, it's fun to think about how weird that song is if you only knew Tubthumping.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping that, if anything, what everyone gets out of this series is literally just that.
Now, in 2003, just about a year after this, by then you have a more modern war, the Iraq War, and so they re-recorded Jacob's Ladder to be about that. But I wanted to play for you the original version because I wanted an excuse. I couldn't have let an entire afternoon of my life that I spent researching the HMS Glorious go to nothing, right? So if I had to suffer, so you guys had to suffer. On the whole, like this whole thing of like sampling English folk music, it kind of works and it kind of doesn't. Because a lot of the songs just have this very placid feel about them. It's really kind of, it's more easy listening
yeah.
than anything Chumbawamba has done to this point.
Yeah.
I'm just going to say that like America's folk music is better than English folk music
yes.
because we had black people.
I think you're actually, that's pretty much what I was going to say.
No, this is like literally my belief. Like is that like, you know, that the whole reason our music was ever good was because of black people.
I think you're right. Like, I don't think there's any way around
that. I don't think
that.
That's even controversial. I think that's actually kind of canon to think that.
Yeah, I think you could like, objectively like a, prove it if you went back and looked.
Like, you think like rock and roll would have just like happened on its own? Like,
no. I totally think you're right.
Yeah. But hats off to Henry/Harry Cox, because he's still
if
still
we go out on one final polishing turds thesis statement.
Is
black people made American music good in the last 100 years.
Just don't steal it without crediting them.
Yes.
You know, because there is something a little bit weird and problematic about what Moby's doing too, I guess. All right. So in 2004, Chumbawamba returned with an album called Un.
Un or Un?
I think it's Un because on the cover, it's written as like Unchumbawamba.
Oh, okay.
So
yep. All right.
I don't know. And then there's like, it's who the hell knows? Like 9 out of 10 Chumbawamba album titles like make absolutely no sense at all.
Mm-hmm.
That's something this band has really struggled with. They have one good one: Pictures of Starving Children Sell Records. That was their best album title, and they've never topped that since.
Because all the way back to Chimp Eats Banana. Boff just never had this down.
Yeah. I think Un is a better album than Ready Made's. It's got a few songs that I really like, although on the whole, I probably won't be listening to it again.
That is my exact thought. I listened to it and there were songs I thought, this is a jam. And then there's a lot of other stuff where I kind of was like, why is this on recorded media?
they're hitting that point, man, where like, you know, they're a little bit past their peak.
Yes. It starts to feel a little fake.
Yeah.
Which is weird to say about this band, because we know they're not fake.
They're not, you know, at all. And the lyrics are always sincere. There's a lot of, like, interesting subject matter on this album. You know, there's a song called I Did It for Alfie, which is about a real-life guy who broke into an art museum and knocked the head off a statue of Margaret Thatcher. You know, which is,
yep.
Fucking cool. There's a song called A Man Walks Into a Bar, which I think is about alcoholic anti-Castro Cuban exiles.
oh,
there's, yeah, Rand, like, and stylistically, it's like all over the map, right? Because like they're doing, they got a little bit of the rock thing left, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
They got some songs with like turntable scratches and shit in there. They've got songs that with like Latin beats and like tribal percussion. And like, it just really seems like they're trying to be like a world music band almost.
That's my problem with it, is they're okay at a bunch of stuff. They're not amazing at anything they do.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know, maybe this like exposes that a little bit.
You can tell it's eight people with equal voices making songs.
Yeah. But honestly though, on this one, I feel like a couple members, particularly like Boff and Lou, are pulling away from the pack a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause there's only like two songs that I think Danbert is on. And if I'm counting correctly, I think only one song that I hear Dunstan on. Like, so I honestly think, like, you know, some of the other guys are starting to lose interest a little bit.
Everyone knows you're not musically as talented, Dunstan.
It's like, oh, we gotta get Dunstan a track, don't we? All right.
He's the Ringo.
Yeah, imagine if Ringo had to sing one out of every four Beatles songs instead of like the novelty Octopus's Garden. You know, like...
Can you imagine?
But I want to talk about a song that I really do like, and this is one of the more kind of Latin-y influenced songs they have. It's a song called On eBay, which I promise isn't as stupid as the title suggests. Let's hear it.
Mr. Kokoschka, it just happened again. Struck the museum like a hurricane.
Sad, so sad.
All of our culture, it's dead and it's gone.
Sad, so sad.
From Babylon, baby, back to Babylon.
Sad, so sad. There's stuff you find along the way and stuff you leave behind. And it all ends up with stuff that you can buy.
This album as a whole, and maybe this is true of a lot of their last third of their career, it's a little underrated.
Yeah.
I'm not going to run around, like you just said, I'm not going to listen to this again. I'm not going to run around and saying everyone should check out Chumbawamba Un.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think it's bad at all.
Yeah, for an album that like probably, I would say, less than 5,000 people probably bought, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
Like it deserves more attention than that. It's pretty good. And when you consider that, like, right before we get to this era where folk-inspired, multi-instrumental shit like Arcade Fire is about to, like, dominate mm-hmm. society, like, the fact that these guys kind of got there first, let's give them props for that a little bit, maybe.
That's true. I didn't think about it from that angle.
Do you know what that song is about lyrically?
Honestly, dude, no. I'm sorry. I didn't sit and look it up. I heard the chorus on eBay, and I just assumed it was something about how eBay is bad.
I mean, like, kind of. It's actually about what happened after the Iraq War when artifacts from the Baghdad Museum, which contained, like, just thousands and thousands of, like, just priceless shit from like ancient Mesopotamia and ancient Babylon and all these like great cultures that date back to like the literal founding of civilization. After America invaded Iraq and there was a big vacuum of power, you know, all these like poor, desperate, hopeless people just raided the museum.
And I do remember that.
And we did basically nothing to stop it. And probably a lot of that shit ended up on eBay, but that's more of a metaphor than...
Right. Well, and maybe my reaction here is part of the problem with Chumbawamba's late career approach.
Mm-hmm.
Is you're making pop music for pop masses. I just don't think people are going to do the research that Nick did to figure out what your message was.
Well, that's why we had to do like a fucking 10-hour series about it. It's because like this shit needs explainers. And And like, you can't in an attention economy where, you know, it's difficult to get people to even listen to a pop song. How are you going to build a fan base?
Yeah. Around and that's that? Why I Get Knocked Down, I Get Up Again did so much better yeah. than everything else they ever did.
But credit to them for not making another Tubthumping. Like,
yes.
Credit to them for never again going back to like, we'll do an extremely simple chorus and beat it over people's heads. Like, they went back to being Chumbawamba, and I respect them for that.
That's my favorite part of this story. They just stuck true to themselves in that rock star period. It's like, well, that was a fun 3 years, and then they move on.
Like, it's almost like they were playing the long game, and they knew that there were certain nerdy people out there that, you know, like 99% of the population is going to hear Tubthumping and be fine and never dig deeper. But the 1% that does is going to be pleasantly surprised when they realize just how much interesting and important yeah. shit is in this band's discography.
I learned about the Diggers, man.
Yeah. So I think I really like that song, just like even without the lyrics, it's just melodically really pretty. Like, they actually managed to incorporate like all the different band members in a way that feels unified. And it's going to be, I think, one of the last instances of Chumbawamba truly bringing everything to the table and being Chumbawamba. On that song, you know, it's not necessarily about eBay specifically, but it at least references an aspect of internet culture that is going to be significant in the decades to come. And this is actually not the first time that Chumbawamba have talked about the internet. On the WYSIWYG album, they had a song called www. Which is a hilarious way to just reference the internet from. It's a very 2000 mm-hmm. brain thing to say. But that song was like essentially about how like even back then, like corporations were using the internet to just try to expand their capitalist outreach and just hyper commercialize society even further. But on the Un album, actually the track right after this one, they did a song that touches upon another phenomenon that is also related to the internet age, and I think that's even more relevant to the problems of the world today. And that is a song about misinformation and conspiracies, which is called Everything You Know Is Wrong.
I was flying on UA-93. That shadow in the footage, it was probably me. I'm the rumor, I'm the doubt, I'm the lie. But you wouldn't stand near me if you didn't want to die. Everything you know is wrong.
Misinformation.
There's a verse missing out of this song.
Misinformation.
Everything you know is wrong.
I'm calling it now. That is a 2026 meme gold. That song will get used.
This is like my whole sub thesis of this episode, which is that Chumbawamba predicted the future.
Yeah, I think several times.
One of the defining characteristics of our age, and the thing that is literally tearing our society apart, and the thing that like just yesterday caused that poor motherfucker to light himself on fire in the streets of New York, it's this type of bullshit.
Yep.
You know, it's just so sad. I don't know, do you have any thoughts, like, Cal?
You can't expect the average person to maintain the level of critical thinking you need nowadays to not be misinformed.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Like, it's easy to look at stuff and go, how do these people believe this shit? And I've realized through time that it's, you're asking people to be on constant vigilance. And only like You know, I'm not trying to toot our own horns here, but only smart motherfuckers can even have a chance at doing that.
Yeah, and sometimes even legitimately smart people fall for bullshit. Like, very good, smart friends that I know, like, have said things that, like, really, like, make me like, go, huh? Like, just, it need not be everything they believe. It's just, like, they fall for, like, one random thing that's just, like, obviously bullshit.
Yes.
And what I like about this song, actually, is, like, if you actually read the lyrics, they reference, like, both legitimate and fake conspiracies in a way, and they kind of intermingle them. Like, they talk about the fact that the 2000 election, you know, that there was shady shit going on there, and the quote-unquote sexing up of intelligence reports leading up to the Iraq war. Those were both, you know, relatively proven bad things that did happen, and they pair that with shit like the moon landing being fake or Princess Diana being assassinated. I think what they're trying to do here is show that, like, yeah, it's stupid that people believe in, like, all this insane shit, but it's also, like, kind of the government's fault.
Yeah, can you blame them?
Yeah, it's like, because, you know, the authorities have given people enough reason to believe that anything, is, like, shady is possible because they've done enough shady shit themselves.
Yep.
That's essentially, honestly, the most terrifying thing that exists in society today, and I think has only gotten worse and worse over time.
Yep, totally agree.
Credit to Chumbawamba for, like, calling it, like, all the way back in fucking 2004. All right, so any other thoughts about this album or songs that you wanted to share?
No, not particularly. I wish I had a nicer outlook, but I pretty much agree with you. It's good. I think it probably is the last of the ones I listen to, it's the last one that's not bad.
I'm going to agree with you that it's the last Chumbawamba album that, like, I could listen to all the way through and be entertained throughout. There might be a reason, which is that it's actually kind of a milestone, Cal. This is the last Chumbawamba album to feature all 8 members of the band. You see, at the end of 2004, half of Chumbawamba, including Alice Nutter, Danbert Norbacon, Dunstan Bruce, and Harry Hamer, they all left the group.
That's like the musical core, but to me at least.
I mean, it's...
That leaving is like, you know, the Bears when they realized Urlacher's done. And
a reference Tommy everyone's going to get.
Yeah, I know. I'm being really...
We could have talked about, like, LeBron leaving the Heat.
All right, there you go.
Something people have a chance to understand.
I can only say what I know.
No, okay. But you're right, Cal. Like, I mean, from here after, like, the group is going to be... I mean, they're never led. They're anarchists. They're all equal. I get it. But really, it's starting to feel more and more like Boff is kind of the main musical director of the band.
Well, I mean, these are the 4 names you probably remember of any of them.
Yeah. I mean, like, the personalities, you know, that we're talking about here, like Dunstan Bruce, he is the guy who is singing in the video for Tubthumping. You know, he's in the press photo. Any press photo you dig up of Chumbawamba, you're probably going to see him in the center of the photograph wearing that, like, trademark red brick suit. Like, you'd be forgiven for not just assuming that he is and always was the leader of Chumbawamba, even though he was a backup percussionist who randomly sang on their one and only hit. But he's significant that way. Alice Nutter, she is this badass bitch who went on TV and openly told people to steal their record from music chains and shit like that. Danbert, he fucking threw water on the deputy prime minister, like, and, you know, flashed his dick in front of Billy Corgan, you know, like, and, you know, and Harry, he's just a fucking great drummer.
He's a good drummer.
You know? So, like, the people they're losing, it's not insignificant. And it was all pretty amicable. So it's not like there was, like, a big blow up, you know. They did this the Chumbawamba way.
Yeah, I literally picture them going to the group and saying, "Hey, mate, I think I'm done." And then that's it.
Like, I mean, it was well, they did it like even more Chumbawamba-y. They had a meeting, Cal. Mm-hmm. They had a meeting. They sat down probably in a living room.
Oi, can I leave?
It's like,
well, four and three against.
It's all right. Off you go. No, but like these four had decided that, you know, they were getting tired and they were, you know, settling down with families. They were starting to pursue other interests. And the other guys took it really well. You know, by this point, they're well past their prime. They're not selling out stadiums. Yeah, yeah. You got to pay for eight people and a lighting crew and
you've got all kids. This shit. You have kids you know you love and they need to go to school. And yeah. You know you're not writing another Tubthumping.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get it.
So it's just time for them to move on. So for those of you that are keeping score, the remaining members of this band were Lou Watts on vocals, Buff Wally on guitar and vocals, Jude Abbott the trumpeter. She ain't going nowhere.
Yeah.
This band needs a goddamn trumpeter. I don't care if you guys don't want a trumpeter. I'm going to sneak into the studio in the middle of the night and overdub trumpets on your fucking folk songs. Kiss my ass, Buff. And they also added Neil Ferguson. He's like kind of like the George Martin of this group. Sure. Like he was their producer the whole time. And he joined the band formally in 1999 when their bassist left. So he's still there. And then they hire on a full-time accordionist named Phil Ron Moody. Ron in air quotes.
How do you get to that?
This is a personal pet peeve that I have, is people with a scare quotes name that's just a different nickname.
I never liked Phil. I'm Ron.
Like, imagine if my name was Nick Rob Vitale. I don't know. That just, I have no rational reason for why that pisses me off. It just kind of does.
I can understand too. If your name's like, let's say your first name is, your parents want you to go by Willie. Yeah. Now I can understand maybe shifting to the middle name when you get older. But yeah. When it's just a normal name like Phil, like what are Phil you doing?
Ron, you know, or, you know, like Richard Ringo, like yeah. That makes sense. You're trying to jazz it up, do something a little bit fun.
But Richard Nick.
So from here on out, Chumbawamba is going to exist exclusively as an acoustic folk quartet.
Yes.
So,
as we all know, that's the best decision a band can make.
I think it's just like the natural evolution for any like leftist leaning punk band.
We don't have anyone who can play drums left. What do we do? Well, folk music.
It's really like just either folk or they just take a sampler and work with that the rest of their lives. But they're too old to try to figure out how all that shit works. So let's get into the first album of the folk era of Chumbawamba's career. And that is a 2005 disc called A Sing Song and a Scrap.
For all those feet in ancient times, for stepping out of line, dragging time and tide against the keepers of the past, the flags of class and caste limp upon the mast. All your week you were someone's slave, today you're a free man. If they tell you you can, then you can.
Yeah, it's all right.
Yeah, it was. I have a contentious relationship with folk music, and mm-hmm. I know what I hate, and I didn't hate that. To quote Mr. Burns.
I don't hate it, but I have to say, I'm sorry to be poo-poo-y about it, but I think this is my least favorite era of Chumbawamba's career.
I am 100% with you. I actually think that maybe this album is the high point of the late stuff.
Maybe, yeah. Although, like, you know, I think that like they're gonna do a couple more after this that I think are pretty decent. We'll probably end up debating that shortly, but you know, they're just I have to be in the right mood for it, I guess. They've got this like very old timey feel that like it's either gonna sound corny or it's gonna be kind of endearing, depending on like how much energy and testosterone I have at the moment that I'm listening to it, I guess.
I think that's my big issue with everything we're going to talk about from here on, is if I want to hear a bunch of British folky sounding songs, I'm just going to go throw on the Beatles or something.
Yeah.
And there's just no way around that for me.
Yeah. Like I'm not an expert in folk music. And if you are, you can go ahead and tell me how Chumbawamba stack up to like all the great, you know, Pete Seegers or whatever. For me, it doesn't rank super highly.
No, I'm with you. I think for reasons we're having trouble articulating. I just have an innate sense like this isn't very good folk.
Like if this is the kind of thing I expect to hear if I go to a cafe
in
Spring Breen, Wisconsin on a Saturday
Wisconsin
morning,
band,
you know,
shit.
Which is honestly like kind of the kind of places they're playing at this point in their career. Mm-hmm. And they're totally fine with that. There's very little live footage of Chumbawamba during this period.
Is it just sad?
It's like, it's expected, but like one of the few videos that I saw on YouTube from like this kind of general era, they're playing in some kind of like hall, you know,
right,
in some small town, and only like 50 people are in the room, but they look like they're enjoying themselves. And it's all like middle-aged people, like just hanging out. And
Boff's idea of music that you laid out.
And the interesting thing is like, according to Boff, you know, who blogged about this a little bit, they didn't get that many shouts or demands to play Tubthumping, you know, when they went on, you know, during this period. Like
I would love that though, that they play some very deep political song, not something they care passionately about. And at the end, you know, Tubthumping.
What about the play the whiskey drink song? What the fuck? No, like I think by this point their audience understood what they're in for, because like either you were a Chumbawamba fan before and you put up with all that bullshit leading into Tubthumper, and yeah, so you know what these guys are about,
yeah,
and you've grown with them, or like you just kind of came in to this music in this later period somehow, and you're here for the musical ride as is. You're here to hear intelligent lyrics and like these like soft accordion melodies and this like kind of dry British humor, you know, from these like kind of goofy,
yeah,
you know, Leeds motherfuckers.
There are dozens of people out there that like that.
There are, and honestly, I don't think Chumbawamba cared if it was like 20 people in the room or 2,000. Like, they're really just here for the music.
Mm-hmm.
They kind of go back to an old staple on this album of like doing a cappella numbers, which is something they're honestly really good at. You know, we heard that on the English Folk album. They did a great one of the Clash song Bank Robber, which is, they do that all a cappella. It comes out great. And then they did this song called Walking Into Battle with the Lord, which kind of satirizes the links between evangelical Christianity and U.S. militarism, which again, this is 2005. That's totally fucking relevant. Let's hear that song real quick.
A new crusade to the Holy Land.
Walking into battle with the Lord.
An army of men under my command.
Walking into battle with the Lord.
Fight the good fight here at home.
Walking into battle with the Lord.
Send those men to kingdom come.
Walking into battle with the Lord. Take my aim with a higher will. Trust my Lord to hold me still. Say amen and shoot to kill. Walking into battle with the Lord. Walking into battle with the Lord.
Nice.
Yeah. It has that combination of being like funny and serious at the same time that like Chumbawamba have always kind of pulled off really well.
When it's good, like technically it's good.
Yeah. I really like this specific dimension of Chumbawamba's music where they do a cappella numbers about relevant political subjects. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know, like they could have, I honestly, like the English Folk album is one of my favorites. Like the more I listen to that, the more it kind of grows on me.
Sure.
And this one, you know, it's about people like in the evangelical community who like want to lust after these wars and invade Iraq because it's like supports biblical prophecy. You know, I remember one quote back in the day about George W. Bush calling the French prime minister and saying that we had to invade Iraq because of some verse in Revelations.
Oh, God. You know,
like that shit was real. And it's fucking scary that people in the modern world actually fucking think this way.
I think we're going to see more of that than less of that moving forward.
Oh, we already are, you know, given all this shit with Israel and whatnot. But that's a whole other can of worms. All right. So that was the first Chumbawamba folk album. The second one was something they released in 2008. And this album is titled, hold on a second. This album is titled "The Boy Bands Have Won, and All the Copyists and the Tribute Bands and the TV Talent Show Producers Have Won If We Allow Our Culture to Be Shaped by Mimicry, Whether from Lack of Ideas or from Exaggerated Respect. You should never try to freeze culture. What you can do is recycle that culture. Take your older brother's hand-me-down jacket and restyle it, refashion it to the point where it becomes your own. But don't just regurgitate creative history or hold art and music and literature as fixed, untouchable, and kept under glass. The people who try to guard any particular form of music are, like the copyists and manufactured bands, doing it the worst disservice. Because the only thing that you can do to music that will damage it is not change it, not make it your own. Because then it dies, then it's over, then it's done, and the boy bands have won." That literally is the album title.
I love it.
They cut
me kind of deep too, because I'm in a musical elitist, and I'm one of those frustrating people that's like, that's not punk, that's not metal, that's not
what you gotta do, Cal. maybe we should title this episode like something that's a freaking 200 words long. No, we're not gonna do that. But yeah, this actually earned, I know Guinness World Records is bullshit, but this got a Guinness World Record supposedly for longest album title.
I do think it's the longest I'm aware of. I know several other joke long album titles, but I think this is still the longest.
No, this is like, they went all out. More commonly, this is referred to as "The Boy Bands Have Won."
Which, I think people should have to just say the whole thing if you want to talk about this one.
It's like, imagine.
They should have done a WYSIWYG style acronym for this. What would it be?
TBBHWAATCATT.
So we've just been calling the album.
Can you, imagine if this album had, like, won some Grammy and, like, and the winner for best folk album goes to "The Boy Bands Have Won, and All the Copyists and the Tribute Bands and the TV Talent Show Producers Have Won." Like instead of like a card from an envelope, they release like a big like scroll.
Yeah, it keeps folding out like an accordion.
But no, I actually think this is like a little bit better than the Sing Song and a Scrap album. Again, still not my cup of tea, but like, what makes it work and what keeps it interesting relative to other folk music, you know, that I probably would just totally gloss over, is the fact that they're doing social commentary and the lyrics are interesting and relevant and, you know, lefty commie stuff that I like, you know, honestly. So I want to play a song that I think is another example of Chumbawamba predicting the future. And that is a song about basement-dwelling social media users called "Add Me."
I'm a loner, alone with neuroses and hate. Anger is a permanent character trait. My letter bombs are primed and they're ready to send. Would you like to have me as a friend? I'm a wound up whiner with a fetish for guns. I'm almost 50 and I live with my mum. I hope my nude picture doesn't offend. Would you like to add me as a friend? Add me, add me. Me mother says she wish she never had me. Add me, add me. Would you like to add me as a friend? Would you like to add me as a friend? I'm a recovering alcoholic, I rarely leave my room. Peeping through the curtains in my dog costume. The voices in my head, dog, will get me in the end. Would you like to add me as a friend? I'd really like to mail you the picture that I drew. It's Kylie's body, but the head is you. I've asked you 50 times before, I'm asking you again. Would you like to add me as a friend?
Yeah, that one is frighteningly ahead of its time.
I know, this is 2008, dude, and they're already talking about how social media is ruining society.
Yeah,
and like giving power to a bunch of like fucking what we would now call incel losers.
Yeah, there's lyrics in there about like, here's a picture of me in my dog costume, here's a picture of me in my Nazi costume.
Yeah,
they're predicting 2024 internet culture.
Yeah, oh, 100%. Like, he talks about how, like, you know, I'm obsessed with guns, you know, like, I've asked you a million times, I'll ask you again, won't you like to add me as a friend? It's yeah, I don't know what it is about these guys. Like, they just, like, they were able to see the whole of how society was gonna turn out.
Well, and as much as I
and they're still chill about it, they're still like, you know, just strumming a guitar.
These things happen.
The equanimity of these motherfuckers is truly something to behold.
Well, and it goes back to what you were saying, that like they're like a political movement first. I've talked a lot of shit about their music, and I don't think they're the best musicians, honestly. But I have to give credit towards their message and their lifestyle. And
100%.
They have their finger on the pulse of society.
No, I totally agree. They were on point with that and with just so many other tracks. And what I kind of like about this whole period is, like, just think back to what they sounded like in 1985, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like the first single they ever released, like really loud guitars, like just agitating, like, we have to overthrow the system, we have to smash the state, like the screaming desperation of people who really truly believed there was going to be a revolution soon. And the same people who, like, haven't gotten more conservative, you know, who haven't really change their fundamental ideological superstructure, but they've changed their outlook on it and their emotional reaction, and the focus is less on, like, world governments and evil, like, multinational corporations. You know, not that they're not bad, but they're kind of picking more at, like, the human level of all this.
Mm-hmm.
How all of this shit manifests itself in society, in culture, in interpersonal relations, which is where political issues hit people the most.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I find really interesting about this band during this period. All right. So in 2009, we're going to take a little detour. I don't have any, like, clips for this next thing I'm going to talk about, but they stopped doing music for a very brief period and they got into the realm of musical theater.
That's always a positive career turn, I'm sure.
It was for these guys.
Like, it honestly feels like an Arrested Development type joke of, like, no, I'm quitting my job, I'm getting into musical theater.
It's like, yes, I did have a number one world hit that we toured the world off of, but what if I played random, you know, retiree halls in Leeds?
He has green sleeves on my recorder.
But that's honestly what they did. They toured Northern England. Like, they didn't even make it down to London with this play.
Knew.
No, this is, like, I think this is intentional. Because, you know, Chumbawamba, they're from Northern England. And so they made this play. It's a pantomime play, which I don't know anything about pantomime. I'm not going to pretend that I'm going to assume that you don't either, Cal.
Oh, I'm an expert.
Did anyone, single fan of ours think that Cal or I knew what fucking pantomime was? Apparently, it's like a very British type of theater where, like, the idea is, like, the audience kind of participates in it. And, like the audience is, like, kind of expected to, like, sing along at certain points or to, like, shout out suggestions for the...
So, like, an improv show, kind of?
Like, kind of, but, like, more structured.
You're a part of the show.
Yeah. The kind of thing that, like, I feel like I would, like, go into it not knowing what it was, and I would take a bunch of edibles, and, like, once I realized what it was, I'd be, like, totally freaked out the whole time.
Oh, God. It's like, they're gonna ask me for a suggestion.
I don't know. Leave me alone. But, yeah, so this pantomime musical was titled Riot, Rebellion, and Bloody Insurrection. And to the surprise of no one, it is set in 1825 at a textile mill in northern England, and it involves a labor dispute.
Funny that the band that did Tubthumping, I now equate through all your research to shit like labor disputes.
Yeah, it's like, if you read this in 2009 not knowing anything about Chumbawamba, it's like, why the fuck is the Tubthumping band doing a play about, like, a northern English textile mill in the 1800s? But if you know Chumbawamba, it's like, oh, this is the most Chumbawamba thing ever.
Tubthumping was the one-off.
So, yeah, so they did this. Like, according to the reviews I read, it was pretty funny, and they seemed to like it. And they brought back Harry Hamer for this.
All right.
He played a politician who was apparently meant to satirize the MP John Prescott, who was, if you remember, the guy that Danbert No Bacon threw the ice water on at the Brit Awards.
All right.
So that happened. And, you know, I'm sure dozens of people were entertained. But, you know, you cannot suppress the Chumbawamba machine for too long. And in 2010, the band returned for what would turn out to be their final album, sort of. Now titled ABCDEFG, this record, you might think that, you know, oh, maybe it's a children's album. That seems like something they're capable of. But no, the ABCDEFG actually refers to the musical notes. Okay. So the concept of this album is that it's about music. Music's power to heal, to hurt, to inspire, to pass the time, pretty much like everything that's related to the human experience of music. That's what this album is about.
We're going to make music.
Now, I detect
about music.
I detect a little bit of cynicism from your end, Cal.
Yeah, I don't want to spoil too much ahead of time.
All right, just let it go. What are your thoughts on this?
I did not enjoy my time with this album.
Mm.
All right, I don't want to sound like a dick. It just was, it's a hokey album.
Mm-hmm.
I struggle. It reminded me of Paul McCartney's worst songs over and over for a record.
There is a, you know what? I didn't make that connection, but they do seem inspired by bad Paul McCartney quite a lot.
It is. It's very much the type of British folk I can't stand. And I don't want to sit here and shit on it, because in a weird way, I don't even think it's bad. It's just not something I like. I can't pretend to like it.
I don't hate it as much as you do, Cal, but I will agree that it's not my cup of, not my cup of tea.
Yeah.
You know, but I feel like I get it. And I appreciate the concept of this, because the whole time, you know, we've been talking about how, like, oh, these guys are political activists first and they're musicians second. But it's kind of interesting that their final album that they put out is explicitly about music. Like, now, it's still political in a lot of ways. But, again, going back to Boff Wally talking about his formative experiences in those pubs with his uncle, and all these English men are just singing random songs that were never written down, that are totally lost to time, that only exist in the context of that specific pub and that specific town, probably. That's the kind of tradition that they're honoring here.
Well, in a weird way, too, that. Man, it makes me like the title A, B, C, D, F, G. Okay, these are a tool we use to make you feel feelings. They're looking at it in a more childish wonder way than I do, where it's like, those are just the notes in the scale, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And they're doing that as, you know, 45-year-old people. I know you didn't like this album, Cal, but I felt like there was one song from here that there was no way we weren't going to talk about. You already know what it is. We have to talk about a song with the delightful title of Torturing James Hetfield.
Well, we got James Hetfield, and we tied him up tight, naked and cold. We kept the strip lights bright. Said, what have you got for us, James? He said, nothing at all. So we dragged some speakers in from the hall. James, 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 just give us names, names, names. James, James, James. Well, we tried every tune in the songbook to loosen his...
There's a part in the third verse where they say essentially, like, nothing's worked, so we're going to break out Chumbawamba's greatest hits. There's only one. And it turns out that's the thing that breaks James Hetfield, and he shouts, it was Lars!
I love it.
So... I feel like any Metallica fan would love that.
It's fun. Just so you guys know, James Hetfield, guitar player, singer for Metallica.
Yeah, okay, you're right, Cal. We get a little too esoteric with our references sometimes, but yeah, not everyone knows that. But yeah, James Hetfield, the famous lead singer and douche pro extraordinaire of Metallica. This is a total aside, but like... I saw one meme a long time ago where, like, Hetfield was, like, just in L.A. somewhere standing outside of, like, a Nordstrom or something and carrying, like, two, like,
obviously heavy... Oh, yeah, I've seen this.
...Nordstrom bag, and it's, like, the
Farkins
meme...
impressing me.
It's like,
all
come on.
I see. Absolute savings.
It's like, what? Is Hetfield not supposed to go shopping?
Yes.
It's like, what? It's like, because you're a metal guy? Like, when I need supplies, I mount a steed and raid the village.
The main singer-songwriter of Death, he had a famous MTV interview, like, a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
He was wearing a kitten shirt, like a shirt that was just kittens. And he's the singer of the band called Death.
And that was way before, like, that kind of ironic shit was popular.
And he outright, that was the whole interview, was him basically like, what, you're going to be, like, brutal and heavy all the time? Like, we're just dudes. And that was his whole shtick.
And, like, Hetfield, like, I'm convinced that Hetfield is, like, a pop songwriter first and foremost. And a great one, I would argue.
Yep.
Nevertheless, Chumbawamba are torturing James Hetfield. Why are they doing that? Believe it or not, it's not just because of Saint Anger. Or Load and Reload.
I love it.
It is because James Hetfield music was allegedly used to torture other people. Do you know anything about this, Cal?
Yeah, I had heard about this. And
What's your basic impression of the controversy?
It's just that it was easy, like, if you want to torture someone in Guantanamo, for example, you put them in a discomfort position and then you blast a song that you know is unpalatable to them over and over loudly.
Yes.
And so Metallica got used because heavy metals, it is abrasive.
Yeah.
I feel like you could do this with any fucking song. I think take the most beautiful song in the world. What do you think is the most beautiful song?
The Jonathan King version of Who Let the Dogs Out.
All right. let's say Imagine by John Lennon.
Yeah, sure.
Even that song.
No, that's going to get annoying.
By like 5 times. I'm checked. I don't want to hear it again.
No.
And so can you imagine any song played 30 times, 100 times?
And what we're talking about here, and this, by the way, was widely reported, like beginning like all the way back in 2003, the U.S. Army used this in Iraqi prisons and in Guantanamo Bay as part of their enhanced interrogation techniques. And we're not just talking about blasting music. We're talking about playing music at ear-splitting volume for up to days at a time. And this is in combination with, as you said, stress positions, keeping, you know, like strobe lights, sleep deprivation, and all of the other horrible shit that we know the U.S. forces were involved with. You know, I read a great article in Spin about all this that really described like the music and torture issue in detail. And it's easy to just kind of think to yourself, like, well, hey, these guys are terrorists. Who gives a fuck if they're tortured? But a great many of the people that ended up at Guantanamo Bay for years at a time and in other Iraqi prisons, including Abu Ghraib, a lot of them were totally innocent. A lot of them were like ended up getting released without charge. A lot of them happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. And some of them were just like fucking drivers for some terrorist leader. And some of them just like, maybe, I don't know, didn't like the fact that their fucking country was invaded by us, you know? And even if they were true bad guys, enemy combatants, we have these things called the Geneva Conventions, which we signed, and so did the UK. And, you know, under the conventions, according to groups like Amnesty International, what we did does constitute torture. Now, this is another thing where, like, I'm sorry to like go off on a tangent because I went on a rabbit hole with this too. If I really wanted to annoy Cal enough to make him walk out of this room, we could do a whole mini-sode about this issue. But like, there's a whole history of the U.S. and the CIA using music as part of enhanced interrogation, as they call it.
Well, this would work on me, man.
It totally would.
Brain works, if someone says, "Hey, you're gonna listen to, I don't know, Cher." Yeah. For like one specific song, we're going to put your knees up by your head, drip water on your forehead, shine a strobe light, and play Cher for the next week. Or I'm just going to pull out one of your fingernails right now. I'm taking the fingernail.
Yeah, right?
The music is torture thing is real.
It is. And, you know, it basically just melts their brains. And it just like, it makes them lose their identity, their sense of self. And it breaks them up. And you know, maybe it is more "quote unquote" humane than physical torture, but
I don't think it is.
I mean, I am sure that most of these people have lasting PTSD because of what we did. And there's a debate over like who sanctioned these kinds of things, and because it's not in the Army Field Manual at all. Like, it's not like the CIA like started to experiment with this type of stuff during MKUltra. I'm not gonna go. Bother to explain that.
Last podcast did a whole thing on it.
You either know what that is or you don't. Let's just say it's just like some really horrible shit that the CIA did in the 50s. But like it started with that. It was also in part of the training of what our Navy SEALs go through. You know, we subject them to some of the torture that the enemy might subject them to if they're ever captured, just so that they won't break. But that doesn't mean that it's good interrogation technique to use on other soldiers.
Right.
There was one quote that I read from some officer that said, "Just because you've gotten a good blowjob doesn't mean you're going to give a good blowjob." And that's the analogy he used to describe why, you know, this type of torture doesn't necessarily lead to good. It doesn't lead to good information.
No.
Like,
yeah.
Like, whether you agree with it or not, like, it's proven that this type of shit does not work.
I think after one day of Metallica torture, if that dude knows anything, he's already told you.
Yeah. And so, like, how does this connect to Metallica? Well, one in the early reports of what came out when we first learned about this shit, it was reported that one of the most common songs they would use was Enter Sandman, right?
Makes sense.
Other songs that they reportedly used included But the bodies hit the floor by a drowning pool, which, yeah, U.S. troops really loved around this time.
Sure.
Understandably.
Yep.
It's a great song, and it's like, it'd be a great song to kill people to. I'll freely admit that. They also used the I Love You song from Barney.
That, oh God.
I will say, even if you are Osama bin Laden, that's too much. That's unjustified. You can't subject anyone to that for 24 hours straight. They also used Queen's We Are the Champions, and they used the Meow Mix theme song.
That one's brutal. There was a little while that whatever algorithm on our YouTube TV was making that the only ad we saw, and that whole I thought I was going to...
You've never had a cat in your life.
No, I...
Why?
It drove me insane.
That's hilarious. Okay, but why is Chumbawamba criticizing Metallica for this? Well, when James Hetfield learned what was going on, when he was asked about the fact that his music was being used for technically illegal torture, his response was, well, let's listen, and then we'll judge for ourselves.
There are some of your songs still rumored to be used in Guantanamo or in camps. They are played hours after hours for the victims and the prisoners. What do you think of this?
You know, if I heard some Arabic music for 24 hours straight, I think I'd go crazy too. I think it's just putting, you know, they're trying to make them as uncomfortable as possible.
Is this torture for you?
If I listened to Metallica 24 hours a day, it would be torture for sure. You know, it's just a thing. Part of me is proud because they chose Metallica. You know, it's strong. It's music that's powerful. It represents something that they don't like. Maybe freedom.
It's music to torture to. That's what I was thinking when I wrote Master of Puppets.
This wasn't even their good shit. Like, this is right. This is their fucking sellout. I was like, no, I can't stand it. They're making pop. What happened to the long instrumental breaks?
You used to have solos in the music.
And I kind of get why Hetfield responds this way, you know, because in terms of not immediately disavowing.
Well, yeah. And if you're in like the depths of the load reload era, I think you have to know a bit of your audience too. I think he knows the dangers of going out there and saying anything even remotely anti-America.
No, because his music is popular with a lot of people who are in the U.S. Armed Forces and a lot of, you know, good old boys, right-winger types in general. He doesn't want to alienate half his fucking audience because of a political stance. I understand why he's trying to, like, hedge his bets a little bit here, but I think, like, just, you know, if you're a more serious person than Hetfield is, you might start to think about the moral dimension of this and consider that it's not a great thing to have your music associated with torture, you know? Like,
unless you're a black metal musician.
Yeah, well, then
where you want that.
If you're Varg, you want to torture the people who buy the record, you know? And actually, like, that kind of relates to something that Lars Ulrich said about this, you know, which is, so this is his take on all this. This is from a quote from a 2009 appearance on the Rachel Maddow Show. He said, quote, "Obviously, when you hear stories like the one you're telling, it seems so bizarre and so strange that Metallica's music, which generally sort of facilitates bringing people together, is used in these bizarre circumstances. It's certainly not something that we in any way advocate or condone. If there are people that are dumb enough to use to interrogate prisoners, you're forgetting about all the music that's to the left of us. I can name, you know, 30 Norwegian death metal bands that would make Metallica sound like Simon and Garfunkel."
I mean, he's right.
He is, yeah. But like the whole crux of his argument there is like, well, once our music is out in the ether, like there's nothing we can do about how it's used, which is not really the argument that he made when it came to Napster.
Right.
And when his music came out into that ecosystem.
Yeah. And I think he's missing what is torturous about the music they pick.
Yeah.
It's repetitive, catchy pop songs are going to be infinitely worse. Can you, because think of this, listening to Burzum all day, something that's naturally atmospheric, even though it's abrasive, and even though it sounds like it was recorded in a fucking basement, in a weird way, that's going to be less grating than having to listen to some pop song over and over, where the chorus gets in your head.
It's possible, although the idea of using rock, like rock music of any kind, was that super devout Muslims are not allowed to hear Western music of any kind. So a lot of these people, like, you know, in theory, haven't heard like any rock and roll at all. So like it's just like blasting Enter Sandman to some like 90-year-old grandma in Kansas.
Yeah.
You know, it's like they're not going to be able to tell the difference between Enter Sandman and Burzum.
It's like it's like making, you know, Sharon from Stoughton eat a bunch of ghost peppers.
Yeah.
She is not ready for what you're about to do.
No. Like, so that's the idea, is that like this music is culturally offensive to these people, supposedly. Although I wonder about that.
I don't buy it.
I don't either, because it is well documented that the 9/11 hijackers, the night before they committed that act, they were at fucking strip clubs.
Yeah. No, what makes it torturous, it's not the nature of the music. It's the repetition.
Yeah.
There's a reason that a pop song would be ideal. And and the more cloying the hook, the better the torture.
Yeah.
Yes. There's a reason you pick
30 hours.
There's a reason you pick Enter Sandman instead of like Orion.
Yeah.
you need to pick the most catchy one. That's what makes it torturous.
It's just like, I imagine like some guy named Ahmed, like 20 years later, like in the middle of the night, take my hand.
Yeah. He's moved on in his life. He's driving a cab and he's like, exit light. Yeah, this is good. I finally get it.
So if you want a contrast to like the way that Metallica reacted to that, you can look at the band Skinny Puppy, whose music was allegedly also used in some of these programs. They got really upset about it, and they actually responded by sending an invoice to the Pentagon for $666,000.
Fuck yeah. That's how you do it.
So, and also, Rage Against the Machine music was being used in these torture programs, and I don't even have to tell you how Tom Morello reacted to that.
Right.
It was exactly the kind of press release you think they would say about it. All right, folks. So this takes us at long last to the end of our Chumbawamba journey. And my, what a long, strange trip it has been, Cal.
This might be the weirdest series we ever did.
The only one that I might compare it to in terms of the diversity of styles and the amount of left turns that it's taken might be Kid Rock.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the opposite.
Yeah, he's the evil, cynical version
of it. Like Kid Rock, like the parts that I liked in spite of him. Whereas Chumbawamba, I like them. And a lot of the music, I like in spite of itself.
Yeah.
You know, it was really weird. But alas, you know, all things must pass. And so in the year 2012, which was, of course, we all remember the year that we were all told the world was going to end. Well, we got something close to that. Chumbawamba called it quits.
Shot her around the world.
It's like, all right, we had a meeting at our house, and we had some vegan cupcakes, and we realized, well, the Mayans predicted that there wasn't going to be no civilization no more. So we thought, well, where are we going to play your acoustic sets if there's no going to be no VFW holds? So we thought, might as well hang it up right now.
And as soon as that happens, like, the UN goes apeshit. Everyone, how can we carry on?
It's like, no, we have to keep global capitalism afloat. Get Obama on the phone. So, yeah. So they called it quits. And the opening of their press release for this read, quote, "That's it then. It's the end. With neither a whimper, a bang, or a reunion."
That's what made this episode tough when I was reading the script. I'm kind of like, I was kind of thinking, like, that's it? It's like that kind joke of, yeah. And It's Always Sunny. We're like, then it just kind of ends. That's the end of the movie. Yeah,
that's kind of what it is with Chumbawamba. It just kind of ends. Except there's a little postscript, which we'll get to in just a minute. So that statement went on to explain that Chumbawamba, as a project, demanded of its members more than you'd expect from a traditional band. And at this stage in their lives, you know, again, they're like pushing 50 at this point. They just didn't have the energy for it anymore. Quote, "We were always as much about ideas as music. And that meant doing things more than writing, recording, and touring songs. It meant trying to be relevant and active and up to date, while trying to avoid the dreaded rut of routine and repetition. Being up to date meant giving plenty of time and energy to the band, consistently for those 30 years, a consistency which we couldn't keep up with in the end. Like, we had to do a whole MySpace account just to write the song Add Me." And, like, I get it, man.
Yeah, fair enough.
Like, you know, it's hard enough. I didn't listen to any pop music at all before we started this podcast. And suddenly I had to, like, at least pretend for a while that we, like, kind of understood what was going on, even though we don't.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, I get where they're coming from.
Oh, yeah. I feel that way with my own career, which makes me it gives me a very good life, and I still feel like that. Can you imagine doing it for what they were at this point? No notoriety, no fame, gigs of, like, 50 people a night?
No, they're done. They're ready to move. They're all living separate lives. They're totally ready to move on. And they're probably tired of, like, whatever little press interview they get. It's like, hey, what about Tubthumping?
Right. You know? I think you could, I don't know this for sure, Nick, but I feel like you could put our podcast numbers up against the sales of some of their last albums.
Yeah, no.
I mean, they were in rough shape by the end, and I get why you would want to just call it a day.
100%. So good on them, and good on them for not doing the thing of reuniting 10 years after and, like, doing
playing the Tubthumping album.
Like, you know, thank God they're not the fucking Rolling Stones or Kiss or any of those, Slayer, any of those fucking bands. Like, they had the dignity to recognize the gig is up, we're fucking out of here. Although I will say, there was a... Remember the guy, John Prescott, the guy that they dumped the water on from the House of Commons?
Mm-hmm.
He tweeted after Chumbawamba broke up. He said, "Well, now that Chumbawamba's broke up, I'm going to go out and buy their greatest hit album."
Zing!
That's a little bit of a zinger. I'm sure credit to whatever intern came up with that one. So, on Halloween night of that year, Chumbawamba performed their final concert at the Leeds City Varieties Music Hall, where they were rejoined by Dunstan, Danbert, and Alice Nutter. The whole concert is available on YouTube, and I actually encourage you guys to watch it, because it's a pretty good show. It's a very sincere and heartwarming celebration of the band's legacy, and a fitting end to an adventure that began 30 years ago in a northern English squat house. And yes, they do play Tubthumping.
They gotta.
Except that technically, this wasn't the end of Chumbawamba. You see, these whimsical pranksters, these Chumba wankers, had one more trick up their sleeves. Back in 2005, Chumbawamba recorded an EP that was intended to be released upon the death of the band's great nemesis, Margaret Thatcher. Well, the Iron Lady finally kicked the bucket in April of 2013, and shortly thereafter, Chumbawamba released In Memoriam, Margaret Thatcher.
So long, you kept me waiting so long.
love the idea of having like a time capsule ready to go.
Yeah.
Just to roast someone after they're dead.
I think that's a pretty cool concept.
Release the song.
It's all right, finally. I don't know, Cal. Like, should we do something like that? Should we like make an episode that we just release in case? Let's Trump is low hanging fruit. Let's pick a musical guy.
Like, I might start recording posthumous things for like several previous bosses I've had.
Oh, that's awesome. I don't know. Yeah, like that's like maybe it's a bit immature. Maybe it's a bit trolly. But she fucking deserved it, man.
Oh, yeah. Fuck her.
And, like, I just love that the great historical arc of this band is just, like, their lifelong fight against Margaret Thatcher, who probably never even, like, knew who these guys were.
Did you hear about this band that doesn't like me?
All right. Well, that's it, folks. That's the end of Chumbawamba. Now, as the imaginary credits roll, I just wanted to like give you guys a little taste of like a little postscript, like what have these guys been up to in the years since this band has broken up? Because it's been a good like 12 years or so. Well, Alice Nutter ended up becoming a successful playwright and screenwriter. She's written multiple plays for theater and radio and has a long list of credits for British TV scripts. In 2011, she was nominated for a Writers Guild of Great Britain Award for her work on the BBC drama Accused, and more recently, she co-wrote the TV series The Full Monty, which is currently available on Hulu. Boff Wally also got involved in writing and producing theater, as well as publishing books. In addition to the memoir Footnote, which was a major source for this series, Boff has also written a book about the British sport of fell running. Do you know anything about fell running, Cal? It seems like the kind of thing you would know about.
No, I have no idea.
Okay. Fell running is this kind of... It's like a British form of cross-country running where they just run on muddy hills like at very long distances. And it's like... It's got this long history like... It's like associated with like drinking culture too, where like a lot of these fellow runners will like just get really pissed the night before, but then they'll still wake up at 6 a.m. and run 20 miles across these like up and down muddy English hills.
That's the type of self-punishment I can get behind.
No, it actually sounds like legitimately cool.
It
like,
makes weird sense to me.
Buff Wally got super into fell running and he wrote like a couple of books about fell running. He also started a quote-unquote punk rock choir, which is called the Commoners Choir, and they are still active in Leeds. In fact, just recently they released a song called Ceasefire Now, which is about the ongoing genocide in Gaza. Danbert Nobikin eventually moved to a small town in eastern Washington state, where he currently raises a family. Cal, you and I have both lived in the Northwest for various periods. Seattle is super liberal, and so is Portland, but Eastern Washington State is not.
He chose an odd place to live for where we know he stands.
Yeah, Eastern Washington State is a very interesting place for an anarchist to live. I imagine he gets into some very interesting conversations at his local grocery store. But hey, good for him. Like, he's apparently doing well. He still puts out music. He actually put out a solo album that's probably going to come out right around the time that this episode gets released. The album is called Coketopus's Garden. Now that's what I call capitalism. Coketopus is a play on the Koch brothers.
Yep. And that's fitting where he lives.
Yeah.
Because they have a huge influence out there on the paper and mining industries.
Yes, as you would know, Cal.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he's doing his thing, making his own music. Check that out. Now, Dunstan Bruce, the guy who sang Tubthumping, he eventually formed a new band called Interrobang, which included former Chumba mate Harry Hamer on drums.
All right.
I listened to a little bit of Interrobang, and yeah, it's all right.
That's actually exactly where I would have been surprised if you said anything except all right.
It was the most amazing thing I've ever heard in my life, Cal. No, it's fine. I was happy when I was listening to it. But interesting thing about Interrobang is the kind of theme that they run a lot on is what it's like to grow older. Which you and I...
Hey, they're singing to what they know.
Yeah, they're singing to what they know, and we can kind of relate to it a little bit. So that's a kind of niche that I don't think has been trod upon too much in rock and roll. You know, even though, like, obviously there are dozens, hundreds, thousands of rock stars that are old and could easily talk about it. Like, why isn't Mick Jagger talking about gallbladder surgery? Like,
because he's not old. In his mind, he's still got
a
hot young man.
He's still got the moves like himself.
Yes.
Now, more recently, Dunson also put out a documentary called, you guess what? It's called I Get Knocked Down.
Oh, wow.
And this is a documentary where he kind of reflects on his days in Chumbawamba and kind of compares it to his current life as this washed up, totally unknown guy that's just walking around Britain alone with his dog. And it's actually a pretty good documentary. Because he kind of asks himself, what did it all mean? You know, like, because when he was, even like when they were doing Tubthumping, when they were on the major label, they were still young enough where they felt like they were gonna change the world. They really felt that, like, what they had to say, they could impact people and make a difference. And maybe they did. Maybe some people heard Tubthumping and did get the political message in 1997. We don't know. But obviously, as we know now, with the benefit of hindsight, the world has only gotten shittier since then. And Dunston knows this. So he's just kind of continually asking himself, like, did I actually sell out? Was the move to the major label worth it in light of what we now know? You know, so it's like this very, like, just introspective kind of documentary. And there's this moment toward the end, bringing the whole series full circle, Cal. He visits the Dial House. The Dial House, of course, is the home of Crass, specifically Penny Rambo, the sort of leader of Crass. He still lives there to this day. And he was obviously like just this major, major influential figure for Chumbawamba. So Dunston goes to the home of Penny Rambo and he interviews him and talks to him about, you know, how the people in Crass reacted to Chumbawamba signing with a major label and becoming this, like, major, major pop band. And Penny says an interesting thing there. Dunson asks him, like, well, what did you make of what we did? Could you forgive us for our sin of signing to this major label? And Penny says that, like, initially we thought that you guys were going to be a voice of moderation. We couldn't handle that. You know, but then he goes on to say, well, but then when you, you know, spoke out for the dock workers at the Brit Awards and dumped the water on John Prescott, then we thought, all right then, you've atoned. He specifically used that word, you've atoned for your sin.
So that is a weird reaction. Because that, I don't know, I view it as you guys were true to your word and that surprised us. You know, you subverted our expectations. But to treat it like you made up for the shitty thing you did, that's a weird viewpoint to me. He only had the opportunity to dump that on the guy's head because he became a major pop star. Like, they're causal. You can't look at it as, like, you made up for your past mistakes.
I agree with that, but knowing what I know about Penny Rambo and the whole irony of Crass, which is that they spout all this anti-religious ideology, but Penny himself does take on this figure of, like, a religious mystic. And that whole scene in that documentary very deliberately is cast as, like, it's like a guy seeking out this wise old mystic, you know? Like, so it totally makes sense, like, when you understand the true nature of who that guy at least kind of is. you can't escape the framework that you're grown up with. Like, as much as anarcho-punk is about rejecting society and digging up something new from the ground up, it is still kind of rooted in Christian thinking a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And Chumbawamba were worried about, you know, the sin of this symbolic move to EMI. And he was looking for, I think, this atonement.
Yeah.
You know?
Tell me it's okay.
Yeah.
Anarchist daddy.
You know, which I think is just a very cute way to demonstrate the irony of this whole meta-narrative that we've been talking about.
Mm.
And lastly, just the song Tubthumping himself, well, it remains a beloved staple of the 90s, and it continues to crop up in popular culture, and sometimes it crops up in places where it's not necessarily wanted. In 2011, for instance, the British far-right political party UKIP used the song in their national conference, prompting vociferous protest from Chumbawamba. A similar thing happened in 2016 when Donald Trump played or tried to play Tubthumping at some of his early rallies. Now that honestly kind of is appropriate because that motherfucker can't get knocked down.
No, I alluded to this a little in the previous episode of like, this is one of the problems with Tubthumping. The lyrics are vague.
Yeah.
To the point where either side could take this song and run with it.
Anyone
who's faced the struggle can apply it to themselves.
Yeah. But, you know, obviously, like, Chumbawamba were really not, you know, desiring of being associated with that. So they did some kind of cease and desist. And actually, just last month, the Deputy Prime Minister of New Zealand tried to use Tubthumping at one of his rallies. He even like referenced, "I get knocked down, but I get back up again" in his speech. But he's like a right wing guy. So Chumbawamba filed a cease and desist against him, too. So it's
now Biden's using it.
Yeah, exactly.
I saw a YouTube ad come up and it goes Biden going, get back up. And all I could think of was, we're doing a Chumbawamba series right now.
Everything comes back to Chumbawamba. They predicted the future, Cal. Yep. They predicted the future. All right, folks, that's it. And I want to thank you all once again for indulging us on this very long, long discussion of a group that no normal person would ever in their right mind think about for longer than maybe 10 seconds.
I guess this is the hardest sell of any series we've done. When I talk to people about our show, I'm not using this one as like a,
no,
we covered Chumbawamba.
It's like, hey, you remember that band that wrote the song with "I Get Knocked Down, I Get Back Up"? Oh yeah, I remember. Want to hear about that for 7 hours? No, but honestly, like, we've skipped entire albums with this band. Like, there's a lot I could have talked about. Like, 30 fucking years these guys were around, and they're amazing people. They put out an amazing body of work, and it's given us a chance to talk about some really fascinating and very important things. So thank you to Chumbawamba for giving us the material with which to work. So yeah, that's it. I had a long spiel that I wrote that I thought was like really clever and all that shit, but
you know,
I don't feel like talking
about think it'd be a, I think it'd be a Chumbawamba-y thing to do, to just kind of end.
Fuck it. Yeah. All right, that's the end of this series. Thank you all for listening. Go find us on social media. Add us as a friend. But no, thank you to our friend Dave, who suggested this series. Thank you to all of the people who recorded that little theater bit that we did for the Chumbawamba discussion of whether they should sign for EMI, and to Peter Mackey for recording the whole thing. We will see you soon again with another beautiful series of another band that you don't care about but should. All right.
It'll be less about British agrarian movements. That I can at least tell you.
Possibly. I can't guarantee that. But maybe we won't bring up the diggers for this one. All right. Rock over London. Rock on Madison. Stoughton Trailers, it's in the details.
torture through music. Well, I've had to listen to radio for many years. I've been tortured.
Voluntarily.
Yes, yes. Sometimes, whoever's driving gets to control the radio. If I'm in the passenger seat, I have to listen to Phil Collins on our whole drive while my wife drives.